I should make sure I stay away from Hammersmith Bridge last night, and that I don't wear overalls.
You don't own any?
She gave him a pointed look.
Women do. They used to in the munitions factories. I bet they still do if they work in the docks, or...
She wasn't wearing any underwear, she reminded him. I just wouldn't go out. She looked down at the small, naked body, and for the first time she looked upset.
This isn't you, he assured her.
It is, Honoré. Look at it. Somehow it is.
It was. And Honoré Le Chasseur had to admit it was a much more interesting mystery than what a civil servant was doing that took him away from his wife and to Bloomsbury. As far as the police were concerned, there wasn't anything to investigate. This was nothing but a coincidence, they said. Le Chasseur and Emily made their way back to his flat. They'd even let him keep the dead girl's watch, or, more precisely, they hadn't noticed when Le Chasseur slipped it into his pocket. It was, predictably enough, the exact make that Emily wore, a cheap watch that she'd bought in the East End. The dead girl's had stopped at one, presumably damaged as its owner had been swallowed by the mud and water. A man with two watches never knows the correct time, Emily said.
What?
Something I read, she said. I can't remember who said it.
I suppose I should be grateful that they didn't think I was a suspect, Le Chasseur noted.
Emily had been nervous all the way home. She had one hand pulled up at the collar of her coat. They'd quickly run through the likely explanations, principally because there weren't that many likely explanations. The best they'd come up with was what the police said. It was all a coincidence.
If there weren't coincidences, there wouldn't be a word for it, Le Chasseur had said.
Hardly profound, and he could tell Emily wasn't buying. So, exhausting the rational explanations, they'd tried some of the irrational ones. A few weeks after Emily had been found wandering on that bomb site, Emily told Le Chasseur a man had come to her flat to talk about putting her in a book about the unusual. Boys raised by wolves, incredible feats of luck, both good and bad. Twins brought up in different parts of the world who met up and discover they've led parallel lives. The writer had hoped that Emily's story would be a good example, one his publishers liked because it was topical. He believed in ghosts and spirits, she told Le Chasseur, and he mentioned the idea of a doppelganger.
Le Chasseur shrugged.
A double, she explained. A supernatural, exact double. And if you see it, it means you're going to die. She was so matter-of-fact about it. This evening had disconcerted her. Hell, why wouldn't it have done? But she was trying to think about it, to come up with a solution.
Whoever that body was, it wasn't supernatural.
They'd reached his flat and Le Chasseur hesitated, feeling slightly awkward as usual. Emily smiled at him gently. It's okay, Honoré. I know this is your space, and I'm grateful. At that moment, car doors slammed closed across the road and two men started coming purposefully towards them. Plainclothes police. If they'd been uniformed, it would hardly have been more obvious.
Honoré Le Chasseur?
Yeah. Hi. I was just with you. It was all a mistake. This is Miss Blandish, and as you can see, she's... The nearest grabbed him. The other hit him in the stomach. Le Chasseur tried struggling, but the guy holding him was too strong. Another punch. Stop that! Emily cried, trying to prise the guy's arms from around her friend. The guy let go of Le Chasseur and rounded on her. Emily held up her hands, tried to protect herself, but he just brought a heavy blow down on her shoulder, knocked her over. Le Chasseur turned and would have got a good swing on the guy if it wasn't for his associate. The other man punched Le Chasseur in the back, right in the kidneys. Le Chasseur tried to stay upright but ended up on his knees, not conscious of anything but the pain. He ought to be used to pain by now, but...
Stay away from Simon Brown, the man who'd hit Emily said.
Then the two of them went back to their car, got in, and drove off. Le Chasseur found Emily was offering a hand to him, trying to help him up.
"Do you know?" she began.
"Never seen them before."
Had they been following him this afternoon when he'd been following Brown? Le Chasseur knew Brown hadn't seen him, but had someone else? Could those two men have been right behind him on the tube, at the antique shop? Emily winced.
"You okay?" Le Chasseur asked.
"Well," Emily replied quietly, "at least we know how the body in the morgue got the bruise on her shoulder."
Emily cooked herself breakfast, using the last of the eggs, which annoyed Le Chasseur more than he knew it should have done. It was good to see her alive. But across London, she was lying on a slab. What would they do with the body? A full post-mortem? A brief time for some relative to come forward? Then a burial, he assumed. Should Le Chasseur go? Would they even be informed when it was taking place? The bruise on Emily's shoulder developed during the night and was the same shape as the one on the corpse, she had told him. He couldn't help but think that the body was Emily. Somehow she had both died and not died. Impossible, of course. But so much of Le Chasseur's life in the last few weeks had been impossible. Was there some way in which events could branch off in two directions? Life was a series of choices, some conscious decisions, some accidents. Everyone understood that at some level. If you flipped a coin, it could come up heads or tails. He knew so little about Emily, but what he knew was that time flowed differently around her. He couldn't explain it any better than that. She just appeared one day on a bomb site, heads. But had she appeared somewhere else, too? Tails. It would explain the identical bodies. Perhaps there was some explanation for the bruises, some arcane link between the two bodies. Prick one. Does the other not bleed? Except that the other Emily had been murdered. If you hit her, and his Emily got the bruise, then why wouldn't her neck break when her twins did? The prospect that there was some sort of time delay, that Emily's neck would just snap in a day or two, worried him. But as Emily herself had said, if that was the case, they couldn't do anything. Le Chasseur couldn't help thinking about Scrooge and the Ghost of Christmas Future. Finding the body was a sign, a warning. They were meant to do something differently, or Emily would die. He tried explaining this to Emily, who had never read the story or even heard of Charles Dickens. When Le Chasseur admitted that he had no idea how Emily was meant to mend her ways to prevent her fate, it joined the pile of useless theories they'd amassed. Was there a connection between Emily's death and the business with Brown? There was no logical reason to link the two, but Le Chasseur couldn't help but try to join the dots. The men who'd given Emily the bruise knew about Simon Brown. Tenuous, but a link. Le Chasseur's first choice of the day was whether or not to carry on following Brown around. The case had always been of minimal interest to him. He didn't fancy the idea of being beaten up again. He was seriously considering just letting it drop. It was Emily who came up with a solution. The men had warned him to stay away from Simon Brown. He could pursue the case without pursuing the man. Around 10 o'clock he headed back to Bloomsbury and the flat above the antique shop. 4 doorbells. One for each of the flats. Not all of them had names next to them. Le Chasseur made a guess which was the one for the first floor. Brown had pressed either the second or third. Le Chasseur decided on the second. The latch clicked. There was no way anyone could have made it downstairs in that time, and he'd have heard them, he was sure. So the door had been opened for him. Very trusting. Le Chasseur stepped into a hallway that managed to exude class and degree of wealth while also being almost bare. The carpet was thick, and Le Chasseur found himself wiping his feet automatically on the tough doormat before he stepped all the way inside. He made his way up a flight of stairs, his footsteps muffled by the carpet. The door on the first floor was already an inch open. He entered a room full of dark furniture, lined with bookcases. They were history books, mainly. There were Russian history books, including books with authors with names like Zamyatin, books about trade unions as well as poetry. There was a small pile of faded newspapers on a side table. The woman registered no surprise to see him. Le Chasseur doubted she would say the same about himself. She was standing in the middle of the room. She was tall, thin, wearing a silk dressing gown that was purple but had probably faded from a vivid red. She had brown, waist-length hair, heavily streaked with grey, but looking at her, she probably wasn't 40 yet. She had a glass of whiskey in her hand. "And you are?" she asked, with one of those impossibly English accents. Her fingernails were covered in a thick, impeccable varnish that matched the colour of her gown. Le Chasseur couldn't be certain, but suspected that the gown and the nail varnish was all she was wearing.
"Honoré Le Chasseur."
"An American?" It couldn't possibly qualify as a question. "And your name, ma'am?" She smiled. "Amanda. And you're too late. He's already come and gone." She looked at him as she poured a generous measure into one of the three glasses that were out. "Drink." It was 10 in the morning, Le Chasseur reminded himself. He wondered if Amanda knew what time it was. "A little early?" she asked, taking a seat. As she sat, the gown parted, revealing a long, very white leg. She covered it over almost immediately. Le Chasseur hesitated. "Do I need to remind you that it's you calling on me?" she asked. She didn't seem worried. Was there someone else here, ready for trouble? Le Chasseur didn't think so. Amanda must be lucky enough to live safe from the threat of violence. This was, of course, how most people lived. Le Chasseur could just remember what that had been like. "No, ma'am."
"I can see you're not a stupid man, Mr. Le Chasseur."
"You can?"
"The first thing you did was look at the title of the books," she told him. "You've read this?"
She passed him a book as she tidied an envelope away into a drawer. "Homage to Catalonia."
"No. I served in the war. I don't like reading about them."
"You fought in Spain. Is it rude to ask for whom?"
"Ma'am, I meant the last war. I was a GI. I fought in France."
"You've killed people?"
She didn't seem too interested in the answer, so Le Chasseur shrugged. "Simon Brown," he said, instead of answering her question. Amanda cocked her head to one side.
"What about him?
You know him?"
"Presumably you know I do. That wasn't just a lucky guess."
"His wife wonders where he's been spending his evenings."
"Does she?
Why haven't you told her that he spends them here?" She sipped at her whiskey.
"I'm surprised they sent an American. I suppose I shouldn't be."
"They?"
"The government, Mr. Le Chasseur, the state."
"I don't work for the government."
She looked at him. "I don't," he insisted.
"I have no doubt you're not on the payroll. But however you define it," Le Chasseur cut her off,
"I don't work for the government."
"You're going to tell me you don't even follow affairs of state?"
If he felt like having the conversation, that's exactly what he'd tell her. He'd lived in London only a few years. He'd not voted in a general election. He wasn't sure he was entitled to.
"We are living at a crucial time," she continued.
"Doesn't everyone?" Le Chasseur countered.
"Ah, a philosopher?"
"Hardly."
"But you're wrong. The dust is still settling from the war. Everything was thrown up into the air. We can't yet be certain where it has landed.
Le Chasseur glanced over at her. She was fitting a cigarette at the end of an ivory cigarette holder.
As she leaned over, Le Chasseur got confirmation that she was wearing nothing underneath her robe.
She retrieved a halfpenny box of safety matches and struck one against the side. It took a moment to get the cigarette lit. A recent habit, then. Or at least the holder was a recent affectation. If it had seen much use, it wouldn't have stayed so white, he reasoned.
Amanda was facing him again, drawing some smoke in. The people you work for, please don't give me that look again. They know this. They think that they've got the power, but it's the power that has them. It works to a new and terrible logic, one they don't understand.
Well, I sure as hell don't understand, Le Chasseur confessed, a little more candidly than he ought to, were he keeping his cards close to his chest.
The atom bomb, Amanda said, as though she'd explained everything in three words. You have heard of the atom bomb.
He looked at her.
You said yourself I'm not a stupid man.
She smiled.
There's a new logic there. A whole new way of fighting a war. Or of not fighting one.
It's just a big bomb, ma'am.
One atom bomb can destroy a city. And with that power...
Ask the people of Coventry or Dresden, and they'll remind you we didn't need atom bombs to do that.
Le Chasseur held up his hand.
Look, lady, I work for Simon Brown's wife. She wants to know if he's got another woman.
She frowned, clearly not believing his story. You're a... what do you call them? A private eye?
No. Well, that is what I'm doing here. But this is a favour for a friend.
You're a friend of Simon's wife? No, look, I... Are you...
Of course we are, Mr. Le Chasseur. I commend you on your resourcefulness. I was led to understand that most detectives snuck around and examined dustbins for discarded receipts and correspondence. You just knocked on my door and asked me. How shall we continue?
We've been having an affair for 2 months. He took me to Brighton once. Heaven knows why. I think he thought it was the form. I've had lovers with more flair, but he makes up for that with...
Le Chasseur grimaced his discomfort, making Amanda grin.
Simon's wife knows already, the woman continued. Of course she does. She may not admit it, but does she think he is in the evenings, for heaven's sake? She wouldn't employ your services if she didn't know. The irony. All those secrets and you're employed to find out something that barely qualifies as hidden.
She flicked some ash towards a nearby ashtray.
I think it's fair to say you've got what you came for, she said.
It wasn't a question. It was an invitation to leave.
Le Chasseur accepted it.
Le Chasseur was followed from the moment he left Amanda's flat. Cheap novels and films talk about a sixth sense, the uncanny ability to know you're being watched, followed, or that a man's talking about you. Le Chasseur knew more than most about that, but this time his method was more mundane. He could see the two of them. It was the same men as last night. Did they want him to see them? They certainly weren't making an effort to conceal themselves. Neither were they in a hurry to catch up with him. Le Chasseur guessed they were trying to make a point. They knew where he was. They knew they could catch up with him any time they chose to. They'd revealed something about themselves, though, and it intrigued Le Chasseur. They were watching Amanda's flat, not Simon Brown. This worried him. There was a simple explanation for all this, he knew that. They were policemen. They were investigating something. But Simon Brown's role? Amanda's role? Him? There were dozens of possibilities and permutations. Emily was waiting for him at the cafe. It was in the shadow of the British Museum and was genteel and slightly old-fashioned, full of the clink of china and the hiss of kettles. The waiter led Le Chasseur to Emily's table, and she smiled when she saw him. They were the only customers here, but the waiters still managed to find things to do other than take Le Chasseur's order. Perhaps they hoped that Le Chasseur and Emily could occupy themselves admiring the wood panelling or the bone china. But he really needed his coffee, the first of the day, and it would be nice to eat some eggs. The men who'd been following him had melted away. They'd not come into the place after him, but Le Chasseur knew they'd be nearby. Still, this was privacy. "Did you see him?" "I recognised him from the photo," she assured him. "Not that there's much to recognise. He's so bland."
"You followed him?" Le Chasseur asked.
"Yes. Are you all right?" Le Chasseur realised he'd glanced over at the window.
"Yeah, it's nothing."
"I followed him. It was easier than I thought it would be. I almost followed him up the steps when he arrived at work."
"Where?"
"Ministry of Defence."
Le Chasseur nodded.
"I see." He thought about that for a moment. "He's a security risk," Emily suggested.
"Yeah."
"I don't know what his responsibilities are, but, well, he's a blackmail target. He could have all sorts of diplomatic secrets."
"I think that would be the Foreign Office," Le Chasseur corrected her. "But you're right about the blackmail. His department would deal with troop strengths and movements. He could work in procurement. That's a big industry. A lot of money at stake."
Emily was looking at him a little blankly. Some aspects of ordinary life, cooking, driving a car, eating in a cafe, came naturally to her. Others meant nothing to her. The strangest things, buying a train ticket, tuning a radio, even basic knowledge of the history and politics of the last 100 years. "What have you been up to?" she asked him.
"I went back to that flat in Bloomsbury, met Brown's friend."
"A woman?"
"Of course, a woman. Her name's Amanda."
"And what did you learn?"
Le Chasseur wasn't really sure how to answer that. "Not much," he concluded. "They're definitely having an affair."
Emily, always a little naive, looked disappointed.
"She told me as much," Le Chasseur broke it to her. "We talked for some time."
"So who is she?"
"I have no idea," he admitted.
"You said you talked. What did you talk about?"